Random House Audio presents The Last Pirate, A Father, His Son, and the Golden Age of Marijuana by Tony Dokoupil. Read for you by MacLeod Andrews. Main entry, Dokoupil. Pronunciation, Dokoupil. Function, verb, past tense. Etymology, check. Definition, to buy it all, as in, I bought it all. Author's note. This is a true story. To tell it, I researched it. I pulled court documents, troweled newspaper archives. When I thought I had every relevant record, I hired a lawyer to come behind me and make sure. I also reported this story, traveling to 5 states and into interviews with the DEA agents who investigated the case, the former head of the Organized Crime Drug Enforcement Task Force who prosecuted it, and more than a dozen former smugglers and dealers, most notably my father himself, who showed me the sights in Miami and New York. Although this is, in practice, a work of journalism, the sources were often very happily unsound during the years in question. Where memories differed or broke down, I deferred to the written record, my father's version of events, or the most plausible version, in that order. Most of the sources were also friends and family, so I've repaid their generosity by altering their names and, on occasion, other details, so their past lives may remain past. The only names I haven't changed, in fact, are those of the 3 feds who are proud of busting the biggest pot ring of the Reagan era, and of my father, who is proud of being part of it. Prologue. Digging Holes. Albuquerque, New Mexico, 1988. My mother tucked me into bed, changed her clothes, and walked outside to find a shovel. She searched the perimeter of the house, a mansion in the mountains outside Albuquerque, and decided on a spot near the foundation, a few steps from an old pine tree. She paused there, poised between one era of our life and the next, looking warily toward the tree line. On a cloudless southwestern night, the stars throw off enough light to read a newspaper, and my mother could see she was alone. She thrust the shovel blade into the ground and turned up the soil. Nothing. She thrust the blade into the ground again. Nothing. She was almost 40 at the time, still youthful, straw-haired, stylish, neither fat nor thin, a fresh golden cake color. After a few feet, the dirt was a little darker than the topsoil, and she felt a change in the air. She scanned the horizon one last time, aimed the shovel, and stomped hard. She turned up the soil and saw the first flashes of white, pieces of a large styrofoam cooler, no more than 3 feet down. My mother removed the lid. Plastic baggies, dozens of them. They were filled with what looked like crustless sandwiches gone rotten. For an instant, she thought bugs had chewed through everything, which they sometimes did. But when she opened a bag, and then another, she found what she expected. Each bag had $5,000 inside, moldy but still usable, and there were bags down as deep as her arm could reach. The following morning, my mother took the wheel of a rented motorhome, 2,000 miles to go before we reached home in Miami. I was 7, working a flap hat against the summer sun, responsible for radio stations and refilling the water bowl for Captain, our flatulent black lab. We had been doing a lot of driving lately, my mother taking advantage of the long hours behind the wheel to draw me out about grade school crushes and playground fights. We hit Florida's Redland region to pick up a pair of collectible cars, which Mom loaned to the makers of Miami Vice. We hit Long Island in pursuit of other coolers stuffed with cash and buried behind a house in the suburbs off I-495. But by far the richest prize was the one in Albuquerque. $500,000 dropped into a hillside at my cousin's house. Sure, my mother loved the open road. She also knew you couldn't take more than $10,000 on an airplane, without telling the authorities. The man who buried the money began to amass it in his mid-20s, selling a few baggies of pot. By his late 20s, he sold bricks of Mexican reefer every weekend, sometimes from the window of a Good Humor ice cream truck. By the time he was 30, he moved hundreds of pounds a month in the trunk of an old Buick, crisscrossing the mid-Atlantic states under the guise of delivering concert tickets. When he'd saved enough money, he flew to Miami, uninvited and alone, to knock on the door of a former car mechanic who imported tons of Colombian marijuana. He pitched himself as the most reliable black marketeer on the East Coast, the best there is from box, drugs to cash. He drove mobile homes packed with weed out of Key West, secured a fleet of pickup trucks from New England, and began to transport acres of South American mountainside up the I-95 Reefer Express. This was the late 1970s, I should add, which was also about the same time that he decided to start a family. He became a father the year he graduated to loads of 10 and 20,000 pounds of marijuana, transported on freighters and tugboats from the extreme northeastern edge of Colombia to sailboats near the Virgin Islands and ultimately to New York City wholesalers, vacation markets, and college towns along the East Coast. In the years that followed, he buried nearly $1 million, invested more than $500,000 more in a Yukon gold mine, and prepared the paperwork of escape. Should he ever have to hit the reset as a card-carrying union welder and avid user of the Monmouth, New Jersey library system. At his peak in the mid-1980s, which was also the peak of the drug war and an impossibly late date for pot smuggling, he broke a weeks-long national dope panic, a drought that New York Magazine dubbed Reefer Sadness. In a single load, he supplied enough marijuana to levitate every college-age person in America and send them sideways to the store for snacks. By that time, the old man, as he'd come to be called in the business, ran stateside operations for one of the most successful marijuana rings of the 20th century. In careers that spanned the drug war from Nixon to Reagan, the old man and his friends slipped every major counter-narcotics operation and came within 1 week, one idiot with a lead foot and a Ferrari, in fact, of getting off forever. In all, they hauled and sold hundreds of thousands of pounds of marijuana, and the old man distributed at least 50 tons of it, an environmentalist's nightmare of plastic baggies, enough bud for thousands of part-time dealers, and millions of left-hand cigarettes pinched and passed between friends. At a certain point, he grew into a marijuana millionaire, as the press dubbed his kind, and the old man decided he needed to start acting more like a drug dealer. He bought a succession of inky blue Mercedes sedans, a 35-foot cruising yacht, and a 100-acre swath of pristine Maine forest, dotted with lakes and capped by a dome of powder blue sky. He moved from Connecticut to Miami, the Wall Street of American weed, where he paid cash for a 3-bedroom home south of the city and doted on the son he'd always wanted. Together they toured the real pirate forts of the Caribbean and had a pillow fight beneath the gilded ceilings of the Plaza Hotel in New York. But perhaps their most blissful adventure came in late 1986 when family and friends gathered for a kind of retirement bash in the U.S. Virgin Islands. During the previous 2 years, the gang had pulled off massive deals, netting the old man and his partner a $1 million payday. What followed was not your average cake and wine send-off, but a week-long bacchanalia culminating on an 86-foot schooner near St. Thomas. The old man and his son were there, along with three other smugglers, distributors and dealers, two other kids, two unmarried mothers, and an escort-turned-girlfriend. Because that's how dope dealers roll. Because he wasn't sure what pharmaceuticals were needed to fuel this exit to Eden, the old man packed everything he could sneak onto an Eastern Airlines flight. Cocaine behind his belt buckle, cocaine in film rolls. He brought a shaving satchel of rare herbs with heavy names like Oaxaca Red. He figured security wouldn't search a man traveling with his family, even if President Reagan had recently run up the battle flag. They sailed along, a dozen people partying on a boat designed to accommodate 49. The parents drank Heinekens. The kids quaffed orange juice. Everyone ate lobster sandwiches and red snapper fillets. They napped on the white pine deck and read Carl Hiaasen and Curious George in the cozy cabins below. The three kids, ranging from 6 to 12 years old, took turns steering the ship. And when they reached one of the area's lush, uninhabited keys, they slid off the stern and snorkeled right where they fell. They swam to the shallows, where manta rays glided beneath them. And they nearly became fish food, or so they were thrilled to think, when a pair of plump, prehistoric-looking barracudas floated over for a look at their father's gold chains and shiny watches. When they went ashore, they fed hibiscus leaves and dahlias to wild iguanas, and army-crawled beneath the decks of beachfront bars where drunks and sunstroke tourists dropped change between the floorboards. Each day ended with the ocean smeared purple, the men holding their ladies close and the kids clustered on the bow, dreaming of shipwrecks, pirates, and buried treasures. The world around was fenceless, and so was the future. But the old man was restless in this paradise. He had broken a cardinal rule of dealing and become an addict himself. Coke and hookers, mostly. He left the party early in search of both. I know all this because the old man was my old man. And when I was 6, I watched him go. My father and I are separated by only an adjective. Big Tony, Little Tony. And when I was truly little, we toured Miami with our seamless tans, wind-blown blonde hair, and Lacoste swimsuits.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.